Welcome to part two of this intermediate PCB design tutorial. Today we're going to be covering what you need to know about the schematic editor. Once you've set up your project and imported some modules as we did in the first tutorial, we're ready to symbolically build up our circuit. The heart of this project is a digitally controlled buck converter. I will be modifying this readily available buck converter by adding a digital potentiometer in its feedback path so we can effectively adjust the regulation set point. Here's the module we prototyped in the last video. After clicking into it, we can start adding parts to the module. I already found this buck converter readily available from LCSC. You can see which user published the part, how many uses it has, and other properties about the part. If you drag this window open, you can quickly check component stock. To add it to your project, just drag and drop from the library into the canvas. In this project, I know we're going to need a decoupling capacitor, so let's move some things out of the way and add that in. Here's an assembly workflow tip that will save you some time. If I'm getting my boards assembled, I'll have to export a BOM. And for my BOM, I'll add manufacturer part numbers to parts I know that I'm going to be using. So usually for ICs, I've done my research and I've locked in the part for the design. For generic parts, like this literal generic capacitor, I familiarize myself with the common capacitor values and which packages I can get those in for a good dielectric and voltage rating. So I'll leave the manufacturer part number blank, but I'll pick the right package to get the right value. So for this project, I know I need a 22 microfarad output capacitor. I'm not very constrained by size, so by going with 0805, I know I could get a reasonable dielectric in X5R or X7R with a pretty high output voltage rating, like 25 volts, so I don't have to worry about derating problems. What we just saw right there was me changing the package size of my component using a property. In Flux, we use properties to constrain our design, and oftentimes there's features built around it. In this case, a user has built a feature where the part changes its footprint depending on this property. Oftentimes, built-in features will rely on these properties, or user-created features in the code section will rely on these properties. And if features don't use them, you can always add these properties to inform yourself and other people looking at your design. As you might have noticed, there is no grid system in Flux. It's just an infinite canvas, so to align parts, you can drag them around and align them using these alignment markers, which show up between terminals. Another way to align parts is to select multiple parts, right-click, and go into the Align menu. This way we can align them to their tops, centers, or whatever else you see in the menu. Another thing you can do when making your schematic pretty is selecting multiple parts and spacing them evenly, or using the shortcut S. This is a useful feature when you want to get parts aligned but don't have a grid. With that knowledge, we're going to fast forward me placing parts in this module. After placing my components, I learned that the inputs and outputs I provided weren't perfectly correct. I have this SIPO pin, which is not necessary, and I need a VDD pin here, as well as an enable pin here. That's really easy to do, so we just deleted the one input we had, and let's go ahead and add our outputs. As a reminder, the terminals we just added are the only way that this module can interface with the outside world when we publish it. Now we can begin wiring. To start a connection in Flux with wires, you can hover over these routing touchpoints to see which ones are clickable. All you have to do is click on it to begin tracing. You can press F to change the elbow direction if you don't like the way that your wires are bending, and you can click anywhere on the screen to lock what you already see. To finish a connection, you just click on another routing touchpoint. Now that we know how to form connections between parts, I'm going to finish connecting this schematic together. Now that we've made changes to this buck converter, we can publish it to the library. As a reminder, you can go to the Flux menu and click on Publish Changes or use CTRL P. Let's add some notes to remind us of what changes we've made. After going back to the parent project, we can update all our parts or modules by clicking on this pop-up menu. Here, you can press the update button to update the design, and there was a message with our commit message. If you check receive latest drafts, then this part will always stay up to date and you don't have to manually update it across revisions. As you might have noticed, there's no technical difference between modules and parts in Flux. It only exists conceptually. Now I will add the rest of the components we need to this top level design. I just demonstrated direct wiring to form electrical connections between terminals. An alternate way to do so is to add net portals or power portals. Terminals connected to these labels with the same designator will be placed under the same net container in the PCB view. We're going to do this now to connect the anodes of the LEDs to the output of the buck converter. Copilot also uses net portals to connect parts together. To ask Copilot to connect two parts together, you can select both parts by holding Shift, right-clicking, hovering over Copilot, and asking it to connect components. Alternatively, you can just write this prompt in a comment. In this case, I had to reframe my prompt to ask Copilot to connect the spy bus specifically, and after Copilot gives you its response, you might see some citations down here. In this case, I don't, so I'm just going to press Take Action. And as you can see, it connected my spy bus from my buck module to the ESP32. Now let's finish up the power connections. I want to be able to power the board from 5-volt USB, as well as leave in an option for a battery if the user decides to do so. Let's drag in a USB-C connector. It's required 5.1K resistors for selecting 5 volts, a USB to serial module, as well as a simple load switch I designed ahead of time. That way we can satisfy all our project requirements. So I prettied up the schematic, and now that I feel confident to move towards PCB, I'm going to ask Copilot to do a design review for us as a quick sanity check. I think it's worth running through while I grab like a quick snack and just skim through its response while eating that. So I'm going to go through right-click, Copilot, and here are some options right now you can choose from for reviewing your design. All this does, again, is input a prompt for you, and you can copy-paste this prompt and modify it however you want. All right, so I'm back. I have my snack, as I promised. And yeah, let's look over Copilot's response. It's really important that you eat a snack while you're doing this. Copilot is saying, it's saying that the enable pin is not connected and I need a 10 kilo ohm pull-up resistor. That's actually a good catch. I gotta do that. It's also saying that the reset net is not connected. I don't think Copilot was able to catch that. The reset does need to be pulled up, so if it bounces, your microcontroller doesn't reset. But good thing it pointed it out. It doesn't know what the correct answer is, but it actually caught that. And at the bottom here, Copilot actually references where it got the information, which is the datasheet of the ESP32. That was a delicious snack, and I think we're ready to move on to PCB. So join me in the next video as we turn this mess into an actual working board. All right, so this part of the video is optional, but I wanted to do a high-level design overview kind of like a rubber ducky session for both myself and so you can learn a bit about the project. Let's start with the power input. We have our USB-C connector as well as this battery connector. The USB-C connector will just get a regulated 5 volts with about 500 milliamps of input current if you plug it into like a USB-C port on your computer. I'm hoping the user would run this on like a 1 amp plug, which I'll add in the description at some point. These two 5.1K resistors do some power negotiation if you're using a USB PD brick. That just ensures that we get the 5 volts on the output. And that 5 volts goes into this load switch that this module ensures that when you plug in a battery and your 5 volts at the same time, nothing explodes. You'll get 1 on the output. And here we have our programming module. This is just a CH340C. It's a pretty cheap chip. It's just a USB device, which has serial output, UART output with flow control. And we're using that flow control, the GPIO 0, as well as the reset for the ESP32, so we can flash it. Here are our on-air LEDs. That's pretty straightforward. I guess we could start here we continue down power here. The on-air modules, the LEDs, I'm assuming, are pretty thermally stable. People say that LEDs are current control devices. That's because their impedance can change suddenly, and you want to operate them at the brightness you intend. It's better to have a current controlled source to regulate your current, not your voltage. But here, I'm making the assumption that their impedance is stable and we're having a 0 volts to 1.9 volt output, so we can change the intensity of the LEDs that way. How we're controlling that is this buck converter. This buck module ranges its output from 0 to 1.9 volts. It has a digital potentiometer on it that's connected to the ESP32 via SPI, so we can tell it which tab we want. We can adjust its output voltage that way. I think we have 256 bits of resolution for the brightness here. And then here's an LDO, pretty standard, 5 volts to 3.3 volts. That powers the ESP32 as well as the digital potentiometer. Here are some pull-ups that Copilot recommended to me. I guess we could tie everything back together by looking at the ESP32 connections. So we have our SPI bus here. We also have our buck converter enable pins. I'm turning on and off the display using the enable pin. You could also just set the output to 0 volts, but this, I guess, is an extra way to do so. Decoupling capacitors for the ESP32. I think that covers everything. So if you have any questions, I could dive into the modules too. Just let me know in the comments.